This small band of brilliant young men had begun a revolution.
But it wasn't just the rich and privileged that made up this group. Working within the newly formed Royal Society was a young man from a very different world, and his name was Robert Hooke.
There's no surviving portrait of Hooke, but a contemporary described him as very pale and lean with a meagre aspect, eyes grey and full with a sharp, ingenious look. His chin sharp, his forehead large, his hair long and lank, hanging neglected over his face.
He was not just poor, he was also probably a hunchback. But in 1653, he had managed to get a choral scholarship to Oxford.
He was a bit paranoid, as we would say today. He had a chip on his shoulder, but he was fiercely loyal to his friends. He was prickly, he was jealous, he wrote his secrets down in code, but he was a brilliant scientist.
At the age of 27, Hooke was given the apparently lowly job of curator of experiments for the Royal Society. For this, he received a small wage and eventually a place to live in the Society's Gresham Street headquarters in London. His skill as an instrument maker meant that he could help devise and construct the increasingly more sophisticated weekly experiments. But Hooke had obsessions of his own. He wanted to see into a world no one had ever seen before.
The world of the 17th century was limited by the naked eye. People knew nothing of the finely divided veins of a leaf, the tiny creatures that teemed in the streams or on the bark of trees, or on our own bodies or in our beds. But all that was about to change. On the tip of my finger is a tiny flea. You almost can't see it with the naked eye at all. And that's the way it was in the 17th century. All people knew about fleas was that they caused itchy red spots and sleepless nights, until Hooke put one under his microscope. This is an extremely precious object. It's one of the very early compound microscopes, dating from the 1670s. It was designed, but not made, by Robert Hooke himself. There would have been a wick there, lit with oil coming from this reservoir here, and this great big bowl of water acted as a large lens, focusing the light through this smaller lens here on the stage where we put a flea. And instead of the oil lamp, we've got a modern torch here, which I'm just going to switch on.
What he saw must have taken his breath away. A revelation from an unknown world.
I can imagine it must have been a wonderful experience for Hooke and people like him to look down a compound microscope for the first time, and it opened up a whole new world of the very small.
Whenever he found something new, Hooke would put it under his microscope, and slowly and painstakingly, he began to draw what he saw. For the first time, we could begin to understand the innermost workings of nature. And in 1665, he published his masterpiece, Micrographia. With its astounding images and Hooke's speculations about the laws that might govern the universe.
It's a most magnificent book. It was an instant sensation. Samuel Pepys stayed up all night reading it, not surprisingly, because it's full of incredible images that nobody had ever dreamt of. This flea, which is an exquisite drawing by Hooke, shows amazing detail. You see all the hairs on the legs, little hooks at the ends of the feet, which are used to cling on to the host. And here we have the most beautiful picture of a fly's head. The way these surfaces of the eye are arranged in beautiful geometric rows. Probably nobody had any idea that there was such precision such geometric accuracy at the level of the very small, and Hooke was one of the first to see this and to draw it.
It was the birth of microbiology and everything we now know about the workings of all living things.
Wren and Hooke had an obsession in common. Like Wren, Hooke had traced the comet's progress across the skies. These are the sketches Hooke drew in his notebook, struggling to make sense of the comet and its brief trajectory. What was it? Where did it come from? And what made it move across the sky? But Hooke and Wren were not alone. Three more men were also watching from the dark. Each was asking the same questions, and each would have to play their part before the mysteries of the universe could be unlocked. The 17th century was an extraordinary time in history. The workings of the natural world were being questioned, and the very foundations of scientific knowledge were being laid down. And it was a small band of brilliant British young men that were at the forefront of this revolution. The Royal Society continued to grow, and so did its ambition. But London was about to come under attack. In 1665, the plague ripped its way across the city. Anyone who could afford it fled to the countryside. And among them was another key member of this small band of scientific brothers.